Please welcome Eric Hosek.
Thank you for that warm welcome. I changed my introduction this morning. I saw the poster out front, and it's me with a fish. That's my picture for TEDx, kind of that wondrous fisherman's smile of, look what I caught. And maybe it's a Montana thing, but I wanted you to understand that part of how I expand my great northern mind is fishing the rivers, lakes, and streams of our region, and that was a beautiful fish, and I wanted you to know I let it go. Just the ethics of, I let that fish go. See, I believe that what we do in the present is kind of firmly embedded with where the future's going. And I'm not really here to talk about fishing today. I'm here to talk about money. And some would say those two are both a little slippery, but we'll see where it takes us. This gentleman here, in the first image, is standing in front of a local unit of currency on the island of Yap in Micronesia. It could be a multi-ton limestone carving. It's money. So for you to join me today in this idea, I want to change how you're thinking about money, because a lot of us in this culture think about money in regards to mine or how much I have or what I'm going to spend it on or where I get more. Or maybe we're a little defensive about money. Maybe we're a little protective about our money in terms of just the human emotions of it. But when you think about money kind of sociologically, it's not a unique phenomenon. We deal with money around the world in every form and every way. And societies and cultures over the years have created money in different, many different shapes and forms. So there's a commonality to money in the global community. We all deal with it on a daily basis. Just as we create art and literature and music and language in different societies and cultures, we also deal with money. So what is that commonality? Well, maybe one of the common things about money is greed. Would you agree in terms of human emotions? It's frequently associated with it. So I got to thinking, maybe the good people of Yap have figured out greed, and if they made their money really big, no one would steal it. And it would just sit there on the garden path as it does and be their currency. This is still in place today on the island of Yap. So I got to thinking about all the intelligent people that work in finance and all the energy that goes into money and all the financial engineering that went into the last financial crisis. And I realized, gosh, if we use the stone currency in this country, we wouldn't have nearly the financial crisis we did. It would have been an entirely different phenomenon in some form, but nonetheless, we did have a major financial crisis that was global in scope and cast a pall over the global markets, and a lot of people attributed it to financial engineering. Well, suppose we took that energy and intelligence that was in investing today with financial engineering, and we moved towards a social good. What if we could do something with our money beyond just investing for performance or greed and engineer a change with our money towards a social dividend? In other words, we get an investment, we get return, but we also yield some good. It's not a new idea, right? The Quakers in 1758, at their annual meeting in Philadelphia, decry the slave trade and prohibit their members from human trafficking. John Wesley, the noted theologian, I know some of you Methodists are smiling, in his sermon, The Use of Money, simply outlines a tenet of responsibility, saying, do no harm to your neighbor with your business practices. Kind of becomes an underlying theme in socially responsible investing. And we see the faith-based groups carrying that forward early on. Okay, I just went from the Quakers to Ward, June, Wally, and the Beaver. That's the great thing about TEDx. You can make these jumps. In a period of social conformity after the post-war years in the 50s, well, 40s and 50s, we saw the faith-based groups still continuing on with their value-based investing, not buying or screening out investments in tobacco, alcohol, firearms, etc. Things changed. A generation of activists arrived in the 60s. You can just about pick your societal cause in this period of activism, but a whole generation came forward and became active. And we changed how we were using money in regards to activism. with this particular approach here. And the reason I'm bringing you through the history lesson is I want you to understand that social change can happen and does happen in regards to money. And this is one of the Gold Star Awards of the last century when we divest from South Africa. On a global scale, businesses and individuals and corporations decided that the apartheid government in South Africa was, if not illegal, at least immoral. And they took steps to divest from it. In other words, just rather than just screening out and not buying, corporations stood forward and said, we're going to pull money out of the country, right? We're going to divest from our engagement in South Africa. And this took a period from the 60s to the 90s, and maybe that's a viewpoint about how long social change takes to take place, but we did get there, and apartheid changed. At the end of the day, 75% of the businesses in South Africa, in the country, signed a charter to their government asking for apartheid to be abolished. It was simple. They were losing money. They were losing their livelihood, and it had been the global community that created that. Some other tools of what's happened with money are labor unions and trade unions have learned to focus their pensions on activism and change in the corporate arena. I want to make the point about big money here. When you think about the California Public Employee Retirement Services, CalPERS, it's a big amount of money. So is the state Texas Teachers Retirement System. AFL-CIO pension dollars. When these big accounts, these big institutional accounts move, they take a lot of momentum or traction with them. You see, in our society, when you own a stock, you actually are an owner of the company. And owning the stock, as approximately 40 to 50% of Americans do, you have the right with that ownership to position the company for changes through resolutions. You can put forward suggestions to the company to consider in changing how they're doing business. Also, a change at the individual level took place in the 70s and 80s. With the advent of the 401k and the IRA, we saw the individual become more connected to their individual accounts, start to manage their own money. And they began to seek socially responsible options. This is also called impact investing or ESG, environmental, social, and governance investing. And so we're going to take a look now with this passing of history as to where we are present tense. But again, the point is, with activism, with engagement, with using all the tools at your disposal, we can create social change. It just seems to take longer than we would like to think in how we think in the present tense. But if we apply ourselves, we'll get there. So this next series of slides profiles where the current market is in investing. And this is a summary of socially responsible investing in the US as of 2014. It's from a report published by the Forum for Sustainable and Responsible Investing. It's been tracked since 1995. It's a great biannual report that summarizes what's taking place out there. The blue part of the circle represents the $4.85 trillion, that's a big number, that is used or invested in vehicles such as mutual funds or exchange-traded funds that are actively seeking to create social change. A little rust-colored band has to do with shareholder resolutions that I talked about, and the green band is a combination strategy of both. There's a lot of zeros here, $6.57 trillion. It's about one out of every $6 in the retail environment in the U.S. One out of six. Now, that's not 20%. It's closer to 16%. But that's a lot of money working towards and trying to drive towards social change. This is simply a growth slide showing the significant increase in assets that have happened just from 2012 to 2014 on the far right. The whole slide's from 2005 to 2014. It's in billions of dollars, not trillions. But again, note the blue band. A lot of money has come into investment vehicles where people are asking for having their money create impact, create social change. Good news overall. This slide profiles the top resolutions. In other words, if you measure socially responsible investing down into brackets, such as environmental and social and governance, you come up with this slide that profiles top issues. So in the top social area, What is, in other words, what number of resolutions have been put forward to create change? You see its political contributions. In the top environmental area, and I realize you may not be able to read this from far back, but guess what it might be, top environmental concern? Climate change, right? Closely followed by pollution and toxins and sustainability reports. People are asking corporations, all of them, of various shapes and sizes, to look at a low-carbon environment, to move forward in a low-carbon environment, and create a business model for that corporation that moves them into the future. The top governance issues have to do with executive compensation and an independent chair. This next one profiles a specific social issue. The Sandy Hook massacre was December 2012. It was 5 months after the Aurora theater shootings in Colorado. As a nation, I know we're troubled by this, and certainly guns are an issue in this country. But I make the point here, we have this effective social medium for change with our businesses, but we seem to be laboring as to how well we're doing with our government in creating change. Again, we're driving corporations, we're creating social change, we need to also adapt and modify as we move ahead with our government. This area here is an area that's maturing in socially responsible investing, it's impact investing, and this has to do with banks and credit unions, just to give you an overview to it, that are perhaps lending into low-income households or building back neighborhoods that have been destroyed or need to be upgraded in terms of environmental services. This is also an area where we see growth in the microfinancing movement, where money is moving out to invest with people in other areas across the internet, socially responsible investing. This last one, again, all these are from the report from USSIF. It details the amount of money that's moving into these responsible vehicles that people are utilizing to create impact or social change. I make the point here that any amount of money can be invested in a socially responsible manner at this point in this day and age. Any amount of money. Indeed, some high net worth families, we're talking millions of dollars in net worth, are doing nothing but impact investing. Are we seeing results and performance? Well, yes, we are. I would like you to measure this yourself, perhaps on these resource sites on the web. This is not just US-based. This is a global phenomenon in terms of where we see Europe and Asian dollars as well moving into socially responsible investing. So the slides I used today came from the top link. The next two, impact investments in particular, gives you a very good overview of what very bright minds are doing in financial engineering to create social change out in the world. Some good things are happening. That's a feel-good sight to take a look at the Impact 50. And finally, the Global Sustainable Investment Alliance points out where we are on our global positioning with this, the advent and growth we're seeing across the board. Are we seeing results in performance? You bet we are. Indeed, some of the stock analysts are now beginning to look at businesses, whether or not they're embracing their environmental, social, and governance concerns. And they're saying that perhaps these companies who are embracing these issues are perhaps better investments for the long term than some companies who are not. Worth taking a look at. So where are we going? Well, I'm surprised we've gotten this far as a species, frankly. Welcome. We made it. We've done some good work this far, and boy, we have a good life, and things are pretty good. So, I'm surprised we've gotten this far as a species. I've realized the human spirit is indomitable, right? I mean, we wouldn't have gotten this far unless we could push ahead day after day, year after year. And I also know that where our human spirit's indomitable, we do need an environment that we can thrive in terms of, you know, the right temperatures, the right amount of air, the right amount of water. Now, I'm a bit of a futurist and I love to go to the movies. So when I go to the movies for science fiction, I'm frequently shown this dark picture of the future, which has a lot of bad people in it, and something happened, like the zombies came, or there was a nuclear war or disease. Maybe there was an alien invasion. But I've realized I don't want my great-grandchild growing up beyond the Thunderdome. That's not the future I want. Now, I see the other future in science fiction where Our cities are floating in the sky. Our cars all drive around on air. Everybody's happy. There's no disease. We're fairly prosperous. There's plenty of food. And I rather like the idea of getting a ride from my great-grandchild in a flying car. Somewhere in there lies our future. And back to my point in the beginning about the present being related to the future, right? I mean, we're the ones, it's what we're going to pass on. It's what we have to move forward. Regardless of what you do in your life in terms of impact in the present tense, you're affecting the future. Oh, I'm sorry, would you excuse me? I have to take this call. Aren't we all a little too busy in our present life? Of course, I'm just kidding. Aren't we a little bit too busy in our present lives and maybe wrapped up with ourselves too much? And maybe we should be thinking more about what we want the future to look like and how we can contribute towards that? And how now in this day and age, as we globalize, money becomes one of those tools which is actionable, which allows you to create impact around your world by working with it responsibly for yourself in a manner that perhaps yields a social dividend or does good for others. So, the future's in your hands. Well, maybe it's in your wallet or your purse, but the future's out there. And you have a way to relate to it in terms of doing some good now with directions you take with your money. I get it. It's still investing. Be prudent and responsible to yourself. Of course you would be. But there are tremendous opportunities out there in this area of impact and socially responsible investing. And money is always in motion. And I sincerely hope yours is going the appropriate direction for you. Thank you.